Let's go, hurry up. Hurry, 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 hurry.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good. You know, I had this like really great story I was going to tell you today. And I was ready to walk out of the house. And Lisa goes, "Oh, you should take some candy for the kids to give them." And I was like, "This is the last amount of candy that I have in my house. This is it. This is all I have. If I give you this, I'll have nothing left. But I know I'm supposed to give and all that." I'm really struggling with this today, you know? Do you guys know how much I give to Children's Church? Do you know how much money I give every year? Do you know how much candy I buy so you little guys can run your teeth? But, you know? Cavities, yeah, I'm really, your moms and dads are probably not happy with me at all because I'm giving you candy. But I'm supposed to be giving, so here.
Hey, no. He dropped the candy.
Yuck. That was kind of a poor attitude, wasn't it? Let's try it again. Hi, boys and girls.
Hi.
How you doing today?
Great.
Oh, man, you know what? When I think of you guys, I think of things that are sweet and fun. So I brought you a bunch of candy to have today. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which heart do you have? Which attitude do you have when you give to God? Huh? Do you complain and whine about it? Do you think of it as being, oh, I must be giving more than everybody else in the church? I wish everybody else could keep up with me. Are you like that? No. You know what? There's a story in the Bible, and I'm not going to steal Pastor Paul's thunder, but there's a story in the Bible about a person that gave with the wrong attitude. And you know what God said? Keep it. He said, keep it. I don't want it. Doesn't matter how much either. I don't care. If you're not going to give it to me with a smile on your face and with joy in your heart, you might as well keep it. And by the way, in case you forgot, I gave it to you to start with. All that money you have in your bank, huh? All those neat bikes you ride at home, your Nintendo GameCubes, all that stuff came from God. Didn't come from mom and dad. Didn't come from grandma and grandpa. It started with God. And all he asked you to do is give some back, right? So, when we do give stuff, and you know what? I know you're really excited because there's candy up here. But what we'll do is we'll let the children's teachers hand it out to you, okay? So we don't do it right now, all right? But what I think we need to do is just pray for everybody in our church and just make sure that we always have a very loving and joyful heart when we give. Can we do that? What do we have to do to pray? Fold our hands? What else? Bow our heads? What else?
Close your eyes
and repeat after me. And you know what? It's really good to be back up here again in case you wanted to know. Here we go. You ready? Everybody, eyes closed, heads bowed, hands folded. Dear Lord, thank you for all you give us. And just help us remember to always give the best back. Because we know, Lord, if we give you a little, you can work a lot of miracles. We love you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. All right. Now what do we do? I forgot. I haven't been up here in a while. Oh, you guys go to children's church, and who can I trust with this candy? Oh, yeah, you're right. I can trust you. Don't give any away till you get there. Oh, everybody, oh, I'm sorry. I'm so rusty. It's been like a month and a half. Get up out of your chairs. If you're a regular attender, shake hands, hug, whatever you want to do. If you see somebody around you you don't know, please say hi and welcome them to Crossroads. I forgot the routine.
Thank you.
lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came from heaven.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came.
And you came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. And Lord, I love to sing your praises.
Yes, we do, Lord.
I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save
us. You came to save us.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on.
And you came from heaven to earth
to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
One more time.
Lord, I lift your name on high. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, and I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sickness,
and I'm trading my sickness, and I'm trading my pain, and I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord.
Say yes, Lord. Pressed, not crushed, persecuted, and not abandoned. I'm struck down, but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure. That his joy is gonna be my strength.
Though the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes with the morning. And I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, and I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sickness,
and I'm trading my sickness, and I'm trading my pain, and I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord.
And we say yes,
Lord, yes. Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Sing that again.
We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Amen.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the glory of the Lord, let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. And let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. And let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the songs of the Lord.
Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us, let it rise.
Oh, let it rise.
Oh, let it rise.
Let it rise today, Lord.
And oh, let it rise.
Sing that two more times.
And oh,
one more time.
Oh, let it rise.
Amen. Father, amen. We worship you today. We bring you into this holy place, Father. We ask that you welcome us here. Greet our spirits, greet our minds. We honor you today, Lord. Thank you.
When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed
It is well.
It is well.
With my soul.
With my soul.
It is well. It is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but in whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well.
With my soul,
it is well,
it is well
with my soul. And Lord,
it's the day when the faith shall be sighed. The cloud be rolled back as a stroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul,
and it is well,
it is well
with my soul.
It is well with my soul.
Sing that one more time, no instruments.
And it is well,
it is well
with my soul.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we at this time, Lord, as broken as we are, Lord, we seek for healing, Lord. As sinful as we are, Lord, we seek forgiveness, Lord. And as needy as we are, Lord, we seek help from you, Father. We humble ourselves in your presence, Lord. We call upon you. Father, thank you. Thank you for all the blessings, Lord, you've bestowed upon our lives. Lord, thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for forgiveness, Lord. Lord Jesus, we celebrate you. Every day we come as a body of believers, Lord. We all have one reason, Lord, to be here. And it's because of you, Lord. And it's because of what you did, Lord, that we can be here together, Lord. Forgiven, washed, clean, Lord. And be a holy nation, Lord, a royal priesthood, set apart to serve you. And thank you for making this church, Lord, Crossroads, and all the people here, Lord Father, a royal priesthood, Lord, people who are chosen, Lord, to carry out your purpose, Lord, your calling, Lord, into this world, into this neighborhood. And I thank you for the leader, Lord, Pastor Paul, you provided, Lord, and you're the leaders as well, Lord. And I thank you, Father, for the way you've enabled them, Lord, to move in your spirit, Lord, in your will, in your very purpose, Lord. And as they continue, Lord, to carry out your calling, I ask that, Lord, you would continue to bless them. Bless them, Lord Jesus, with the truth of your word. Bless them, Lord, with the power of your Holy Spirit and with the love, Lord, that bonds them together, Lord, as a body of believers. Pray that, Lord, you would help them, Lord, to do your mind, Lord, to know your mind and to do your will, loving each other, Father. Pray that you would continue to bring new members, Lord, and help the outreach team, Lord, Father, to continue reaching out to those around them. And Father, continue to bless Pastor Paul, Lord. Bless him, Lord, Father, with word of wisdom, Lord Jesus, truth of your word, Lord, so that he can speak to us, Lord, and so that we might be edified and we might grow in our faith. And today, Lord, as he stands to speak, Father, and you know his heart, he desires to speak what you want him to speak. So speak through him, Father. And pray that you bless Gordon, Lord, as he reads your scripture, Father. Lord, be the center of everything we do today as we continue to worship you. We love you, Father. We thank you and we ask you all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you have your Bibles and want to open up to Hebrews chapter 11.
Okay, if you have your digital Bible, you're going to beam them, the scriptures? All right.
Yeah. And we're going to be reading verses 1 through 4. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for, and certain for what we do not know, or do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man. When God spoke well of his offering, and by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead.
Have you ever been looking for something you know is there, but sometimes you can't quite see it? You've been told it's there, or you've experienced it there in the past, but then sometimes when you're searching for it, it's not quite within your grasp or within your sight. I was having one of those kind of experiences yesterday. We were at a thing called a focused living retreat, and it was just a tremendous blessing in my life, and I think of those that attended as well, of just taking a moment set aside to think about, reflect, pray, and listen to God regarding God's calling in your life and where God has blessed you in terms of spiritual gifts and ministry and in terms of what God wants you to do. I just want to take a few seconds to have persons stand that participate in that throughout the weekend. If you just stand, I want to pray a special prayer for you, and then I'll share the rest of my story. There was 40 of us all together that were there for the weekend, and if you'd like to sign up for, they're going to do a follow-up class on it that may be on Sunday mornings or an evening. It's called the Focused Living Retreat Handbook, and it would just be a tremendous blessing in your life. Lord, I just pray for those persons today, for those that are here and those that are probably weary and are home just reflecting and thinking this day, that, Lord, you'd be with them. Allow them to follow through in the commitment they made this weekend to live a focused life, focused on you, focused on your word, and focused on serving others. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Well, I was at this Focused Living Retreat. We were blessed by another area church called Chapel Hills that allowed us to use their building. And if you've ever been to Chapel Hills Church, it's a great church. My friend John is a pastor there. And it's just off of Pilot Knob across from Diamond T Ranch. And they have this beautiful park and horse riding trails and so forth there. And as I was taking one of the free time breaks we have for just listening to God, talking, walking around, I could hear the horses kind of down, probably about, it seemed like just in just a few yards away, but it actually was down a large hill and kind of probably closer to 50 yards away. But I could hear those horses, and I remember being in that park before, walking those beautiful trails along the lake. I thought, you know, I'm up on the hill here. I know the trail is somewhere down. If I keep walking straight, I'm bound to hit it, right? Laws of geometry, laws of physics. Good in theory, correct? And so that's exactly what I started out to do. I started heading down to where I could hear the horses kind of going. Was that pretty good? I did better? Okay. Oh, good. All right. For those of you who are new to our church, I work on my animal sounds profusely. I have a confirmation class that every time I come on Wednesday nights, it's the ducks, geese, sheep, whatever, we just practice them for fun. And so I was working down towards these horses, and there was a large trail down there somewhere I knew I'd heard about. There was evidence I could hear people walking on it, but I had to get there first, and I had to walk through this thick brush. The first thing I had to conquer was the hill. I didn't realize how steep this was and that it had rained recently. I found that out, of course, as I bounced my way down, particularly on these wonderful things, I think they call landscaping stones. And I thought, well, this is kind of fun. I created my own little mudslide, just like the beavers. So I kind of wiped myself off from that. I think, well, you know, a little bit of digging tack. Nobody hopefully saw me, you know. Wiped the mud off, and then I start walking through the bramble bushes. And that was kind of fun, all those little stickers all over you. So you start working your way through those. And then all of a sudden I hit to the really thick hedges where you're just kind of like wishing you had the machete. Ugh. But I could hear the horses. down the side. So I could focus on that. Okay, if I can just get to this trail. And finally, I realized I'd finally hit the trail because there was an evidence of something unseen, but you could smell. And I found it quite easily. And sometimes that's the way it is as we go through our journey. We have the faith. We know somehow in our belief system that the trail is out there, or the thing that we're trying to achieve is out there. But it's getting through the brambles of life, the hardships, the perseverance, the realizing that it's something beyond what we can see, but if we just keep working, that we can get there. Our scripture today is a great story, a wonderful story. In fact, this whole next series for the next 2 months is based on the heroes of faith, Hebrews chapter 11. And if you've never read that passage, I would just challenge you to read through all of Hebrews 10, 11, and 12 to put it in context. It was great when Bodley prayed about the royal priesthood, because that's the context of what the discussion is about, that we are Christ's royal priesthood. And as priests, we're all called to minister. We talked about that in our Focused Living Retreat yesterday, that what's unique about the Protestant movement that separated from Catholicism at the time was to say that priests are not the only ones who serve and minister. What's important is that each of us are called to our own ministry. In fact, Martin Luther coined the phrase, the priesthood of all believers. And that's what we're really called to do. And in Hebrews, it talks about that each of us are ordained and called by God for ministry and service. And it's part of discovering that calling. And we do that through our faith experience. I want to turn you to your scriptures this morning, or if you take your insert and follow along, I want to read a passage from Hebrews 11, 1. It says, "Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, they understood that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible." In other words, God created from just from nothingness, from his word. It says it came forth. This understanding of faith is key to what Abel did in terms of his sacrifice. If you go back to the story that was just read by Gordon, I want to take you back to another story that he's actually quoting from, and that's Genesis chapter 4. You have your Bible, turn to that. It talks about Adam and Eve having their first children with the help of the Lord, and it says, "Now Abel kept flocks," Genesis 4:2, "and Cain worked the soil. And in the course of time, Cain brought forth some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought forth fat portions and from some of the firstborn of his flock. And the Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast." That term downcast in the Hebrew literally means that he had a scowl, a troublesome look. It's almost linked with evil. And when someone is downcast, that's why the song we sang today, I'm Trading My Sorrows, is such a wonderful song, because it reminds us that when we are downcast, that we can trade those in for the joy of the Lord. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face so downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin," and in many translations, the King James, I like that it says Satan. Satan is crouching at your door. Just picture Satan like a lion, waiting to pounce. It desires to have you, but you must master it. You must master it. So we have this context of Abel and Cain. And the first story of where faith is talked about in terms of faith in God. And what we find out here from Abel is Abel has a strong faith in God, so much so that he gives a sacrifice. And really, that's what I want to talk about today, is how Abel had such a worthy sacrifice. So many theologians discuss this. What made the sacrifice worthy? Why was it important? Why is it mentioned in the New Testament? Why was it so significant? I think a lot of theologians, when they argue about this, just don't think about it enough. What they do is they try to look too much into it, maybe. That's the way. Some theologians argue about this, well, it's an offering difference because one gave an animal sacrifice and one gave a sacrifice of wheat or something of the, and it's not anything to do with that. It's not whether it was an animal or if it was a wheat offering or whatever it was. What it was a sacrifice of faith that made it worthy. If my first point I want to share with you today is that very same premise, that faith is what makes a worthy sacrifice. Faith. When we give on Sunday morning in our offering, it's not the money itself that's important as much as the faith we have that when we put this offering in the plate, that is going to do some miracle for God. That we're going to use it as good stewards to further the cause of Christ in this area. There's actually a term there in the Greek. It's called piste. And it literally means beyond belief. It's an understanding that it goes beyond being able to just physically, tangibly look at something and deal with it. It means that it has to be beyond what you can tangibly see. That's why it's the evidence of things unseen. And the term evidence unseen is paramaton eklos, which literally means a thought that has been cross-examined. In other words, that what is put to the test is not only something that we can see, but also our thoughts, our vows, our words. They're cross-examined by God. A second thing I think that Abel offered in a worthy sacrifice is that he gave a worthy sacrifice with an attitude of generosity. Many times I think that this is the major premise of why Cain's sacrifice was rejected and Abel was warmly affirmed by God. Let's look at the scripture again. 11:4 from Hebrews. It says, "By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did." A better sacrifice than Cain did. I think it was a better sacrifice because he gave with his whole heart. And that's what generosity means. It means giving with your whole heart. Not just, it's not what you take out of your billfold, but what's in here when you give. How you're feeling about that gift. If you have your Bible and you want to turn to Luke chapter 12, verse 32, there's a great passage. Many of you could probably quote this from memory. It reminds us of where our giving really comes from. Luke 12, 32 through 34 talks about this. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. Isn't that right? Many times we can look at where our treasure is. We take out our checkbook, we take out our day timer or calendar, and you just look at where you spend your money and your time. That's your treasure. And where you spend those things is where your heart is. And so a worthy sacrifice has that sense of generosity of your time and the generosity of time with your finances, because that's where your heart is. There's a story about a young mother who was doing a sociological study. And she had gone back to school as kind of a second career move. And as she went back to school, she was doing this study on kind of how people interact with one another in sociology. They tend to do sample surveys, they read literature, they go out and do observations, and this is what she was doing. She was doing observation and analysis and how people work with the poor, and particularly how are they generous or not generous, or how are they treated or how are they accepted or rejected. And she read a lot of books about it. She would go to homeless shelters, just like our group is going to Simpson Shelter. What day is that again? The 13th. Oh, yeah, that's great. Thanks for quoting that. All right. And that'd be something if you're interested in. It's a great ministry. I love going down there. And they were, it was the type of thing she was doing, was going to these shelters and kind of watching how homeless were treated and how people ministered to them. And she was working on her paper one day, just kind of making observations and thinking things through. And she took her two kids with her to go get a couple Happy Meals. Any parents ever done that? He's trying to think, I need to get some work done. Let's I'll take them to that little jungle thing, you know, and let them play in the ball pit while I write a few things. That's what she was doing. And so they were playing in the playground thing, and she was working on some works. And then she noticed, first of all, because of the smell, that something was different. And as she looked up from her paperwork, she noticed there were two homeless gentlemen that were just kind of standing there, watching people, looking to see if they left any scraps so that they could pick them up and eat them off the tables. And she saw that a lot of people were kind of moving away from them. She noticed that several of them actually, when they noticed that they were picking up table scraps, purposely took their paper and wadded it up really tight and shoved it way down in the garbage so these guys would have to reach way down if they really did want it, rather than just leaving it on the table for them. She was kind of taking notes, observing how some people kind of looked at them or smelled them, or and how the whole playland kind of began to disappear, and mommies got their little kids up and picked up their coats and left. And pretty soon it was just kind of her and her kids and this homeless couple of men that were there. And she again was just kind of observing, writing these things down. And as she was observing, all of a sudden she noticed this little child that happened to be her own walk up with a Happy Meal and say, would you like some of my cheeseburger? You look like you're hungry. And all of a sudden it broke the mother's heart. She realized that her little daughter had the generosity that she did not have. She was just watching. She was observing. She was being a social scientist. But her daughter was giving it with a generous heart. Because of her daughter's prompting, she walked up to these two men. She said, you know, you look like you're kind of hungry. Can I buy you a cup of coffee or some food? And they said, oh, that would be so great. Because if we don't buy something soon, then the manager will come in and kick us out. And we go through this from restaurant to restaurant. And if you could, that would be so great. So she went up the counter. She got them some food. They sat down and they talked. They talked. And she found out really from the inside what it's like to be homeless, not by observing, but by asking and being part of their life. And at the end, they were thanking her profusely. And she said, you know what? No, I need to thank you for giving me this opportunity. And I just want you to know the reason that I was generous wasn't because I was thinking about it, it was because of my daughter and her generous spirit. And I want you to know that because I go to church, the reason that I'm generous is because I know that God has blessed me so much. And she left them with some extra money so they could be taken care of in the future as well. You see, that's the kind of heart attitude that God wants in us. He wants us to give not out of obligation, not because we have to, but because we want to. He wants us to give from our heart. He doesn't want half-hearted Christians. That's why he said in that passage, where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. If I'm going to get angry about something, I get angry about Christians who give out of obligation because we have so much to be thankful for. We have so much to give out of the joy of the Lord. I'm sick and tired of half-hearted Christians who say, you know what, I guess if I have to set up on Sunday morning, I will, if Pastor Paul, I'd rather have you come in the morning and say, you know what, are there some extra chairs I can put up? That'd be awesome. I loved we had a couple new guys this morning that asked if they could be on our setup team. Isn't that incredible? Yeah. You know, because they wanted to serve, not because they were being coerced. Well, maybe a little bit. I don't remember really the whole conversation. At least they were here, right? No. But that sense of giving out of your whole heart, not your half-hearted attitude. It's the difference between a servant and a slave. A servant gives because they have a serving heart. And a slave gives because they're owned or it's out of obligation. God wants us to give with a generous heart, one that shows love for Him, one that shows that we care about Him. I think part of that generous heart is realizing that sometimes we give out of a sense of legalism. And I think that that's kind of what Cain's sin was, when you look at it, was that sense of legalism. John Maxwell stated it very well. He said, you can't be generous and legalistic at the same time. You can't be generous and legalistic at the same time. That's kind of the elder brother syndrome from the prodigal son story. Remember when his younger brother came back and his dad came out and was generous and said, you know, welcome back to the family. Let's throw the party with the fatted calf. And his older brother, what was his response? Do you remember? Why does he get the party? Why are we being generous to him? Don't you remember I was here the whole time? Don't you remember all the things I did? He never threw me a party. His brother was counting who was better. He was looking and observing. And right there, we know from God's word what happens. When you keep score, you allow Satan to creep in. When you start keeping score about who's doing what, when, and where, that's when Satan gets a foothold. That's exactly what happened to Cain. As he began to look at his brother, and rather than being joyful in the fact that God loved his sacrifice and celebrating with him and maybe saying, hey, I noticed God just really took favor upon you. What did you do different than I did in order to receive such favor? Instead, he allowed Satan to creep in and say, you know what? If he's going to get that kind of recognition, I'm going to take him out. I want that kind of recognition. I want God to say he loves me more than him. Have you ever had that feeling where Satan's creeping in your heart? Where you look at a brother and sister and go, I wish I had that kind of house, or I wish I had that kind of car. When you've looked at someone and said, I wish I had that kind of job. And you allow Satan just to kind of creep in because you start doing that comparison. You start that looking at them. You start getting legalistic. Or sometimes we get legalistic in the church. We think because we're serving on a committee or a team or a task force that somehow we're giving more than the other person. And when they come in, we start to feel resentful of them, saying, well, I wish they were working as hard as I was. And so easily we can allow Satan to come in. Or we can be from the other side too, where we can get legalistic, thinking, well, all we did is that Jesus loves me, that's all I need to know. And we can even have that type of grace can become legalism. Where we have a cheap grace rather than a grace-serving attitude. Genesis 4:7 states it very well. If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, Satan is crouching at your door, and he desires to have you, but you must master it. That's the challenge for us, is that when we feel sin is there, we have to master it. It's a story, although it has some recognition in my family, I want to put a disclaimer. This has nothing to do with any people in my family. Somebody from the first service said, well, you said the word Josh. I said, well, that was just, the word came out. It has nothing to do with my family. Just a story about a similar family, okay? I guess my children are out there somewhere. This family had a difficulty with their son and daughter kind of fighting. And the mother was kind of refereeing, as sometimes is the case. And while she was refereeing, the young boy was chasing the sister around, and all of a sudden he caught her and he gave her a swift kick. And then she starts screaming, Mom, Mom, and he grabbed her hair and started pulling on, Mom, he's pulling my hair. Never happened at your house, right? Never happened? Okay. And all of a sudden this young little boy gets grabbed by the mom and says, hey, let go of her hair, and sat on her lap. And then he came up with a phrase that maybe you've heard or maybe you've said yourself, she said to the young boy, why did you do this? Why are you beating up on your sister? Why are you pulling her hair? Why are you kicking her? And the young boy said, well, the devil made me do it. You ever heard that phrase? Old Flip Wilson thing, I think. The devil made me do it. And sometimes we can blame the devil, and I'm not saying that Satan isn't out there tempting us, but we can't give him all the credit. This young boy's response, I think, was quite interesting. He said, well, the devil did make me kick her, but the pulling her hair, that I did myself. I think sometimes we have to admit, what is it we've done ourselves, and not blame the evil one, because God has given us due warning, just like he did Cain and Abel. He said, bring me a sacrifice. And when they did, one had not the desire in his heart, and the other one did. It was nothing that Abel did to Cain to make him feel that way. He did it himself. And when sin is crouching at our door, that's the attitude that we have to be careful of, is not to become legalistic and not to give out of obligation, but generosity. The last point I'd like to bring up this morning is a worthy sacrifice leaves a legacy. A worthy sacrifice leaves a legacy. Again, turn to God's word. In 11:4, the second part says this. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. How would you like to have that on your tombstone? I would just love to see Pastor Paul was a righteous man. Oh, wouldn't that be great? That's what he was remembered for. This is his epitaph in the Book of Remembrance. That he was remembered in both Genesis and in Hebrews as a righteous man. He did what was right before the Lord. Even though he had a short life, we only know a little bit about him. He He was remembered as the faithful heroes in Hebrews 11. Think of all the people that were left out. He was remembered because he was a righteous man. And God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead. In other words, when we give a worthy sacrifice, we bless our loved ones, not only now, but for generations to come. That's one of the things I love about putting money in the offering plate every Sunday, is I know that I'm blessing my children who come here. I know I'm blessing my grandchildren who may attend here someday, maybe my great-grandchildren. That we're building something here at Crossroads Church that so many people never have an opportunity to do. Do you realize how special it is to be part of a pioneering church plant, to have that pioneering spirit? Do you realize that because of what you're doing as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, that someday there's going to be a building set up on Cedar and Dodd? And for generations to come, people are going to come there and their children are going to be nurtured in the faith. People are going to come to receive Jesus Christ for an eternity. That there will be lives changed. There's going to be a community of people living around that church who may never have heard of Jesus Christ or experienced his love. And by you putting a dollar in a plate that gets passed on and multiplied through others giving as well, that we leave a legacy behind. We leave a legacy of ministry. We leave a legacy of a building and a new community that we're building. We leave a legacy of changed lives. If you were at the Focus Living Retreat yesterday, raise your hand if you felt your life was changed by being there. Look around, folks. Changed lives, that's what we're about. That's the legacy, more than any building we'll even leave behind, is the fact that Jesus Christ is in this place. And by faith, we're accepting that premise that someday we're going to see the victory, we're going to see the rewards on this earth, but even more importantly, in the world to come. We will never fully experience, Abel never experienced fully the promise, did he? He was killed by his brother. If you go through the heroes of faith, many of them never experienced, like Moses, the promised land. He led them right to it. But those, the generations after him, lived the legacy of Moses freeing them from Egypt. My dad gave generously to this church. And even his death still continues to give. Because he wanted to see this place built. He wanted to see a legacy left behind of faithfulness. My challenge for you this day, folks, is that you live a life worthy of a sacrifice and that you give a worthy sacrifice to God and to others. Because God wants you to give. But he doesn't want you to give out of obligation. He wants you to give out of love. He wants you to give out of a servant's heart. And he wants you to share that love with others. As we move into a time of communion, I want to share with you a story. This is a story about a missionary that I heard about when I went to a mission meeting this week. And this missionary was serving in the area of the Middle East near Lebanon in 1984. And this missionary's name was Reverend Weir. And Raymond Weir, you may have heard the story already, was taken into captivity in 1984 and was one of the hostages during that time of conflict. And what happened is when he was taken into captivity, he was, of course, beaten for his faith. He was put into a small isolation cell where many times there was not even any light except for when they brought the food in and out. And even his rations were just simply bread and water as those that were the negotiators continued for negotiating for his release. What's significant about Reverend Weir was the fact that he happened to one day remember the fact that it was a Sunday. He tried to keep track of all the different days. And having been a pastor, he also recognized that it was Communion Sunday. This celebration we're having today is called Worldwide Communion Sunday, where denominations throughout the world this day are having communion, just like us. He happened to be a Presbyterian pastor, but Catholics, Lutherans, Methodists, Baptists, Episcopalians, Evangelicals, free churches, all around the world today, we've decided to say, you know what, let's have a unity Sunday where we pray for each other's churches and we lift up the unity of the body of Christ through the bread and the wine. A Reverend Weir was there that day in his prison cell with no one to share this communion with. And like usual, they came in, they threw his bread on the floor and they set his water down in a dog dish and a bowl on the floor. He picked it up, and he took it that day. And the simple bread that he was given that day, he blessed it, and he broke it, thinking about the millions upon millions of almost a billion Christians around the world this day that were celebrating communion. And so when he broke that bread, he did it knowing that there was a common table throughout the world. He remembered the passage from 1 Corinthians 11 that stated that when Jesus was with his disciples, he took the cup and poured it out and said, "Take, drink. This is the new covenant, my blood, shed for you. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." He remembered that passage. There alone in his dark cell, with no one else to share the meal. In his mind, he was sharing it with the hundreds of millions of people around the world that day. They were celebrating Worldwide Communion Sunday. And as he ate the bread, and he drank from his water, he imagined that water being wine. And he imagined each of us celebrating this in the love of Jesus Christ. And he said a little prayer that day for his captives, for those who had taken him in and were persecuting him at this time. He said, "You know, Lord, I just pray that someday their lives will be changed, that I can be a worthy sacrifice. If they kill me, that somehow in my death, new life will begin. But somehow that these people's lives will be changed." The testimony that I heard from this man was impressive because he was released from captivity. His prayer was answered. And not only was it answered in that way, it was answered because of the fact that 20 years later, there's now a church in that community, a pioneering spirit church like Crossroads that said, "You know what? We are going to plant in this corner a place with the body of Jesus Christ where people can come to know the blood of Jesus and his life-giving atonement for our sins." And in that way, he took with him just a little piece of that generous spirit of a worthy sacrifice, and he shared it with those around him. In a little bit, we're going to come forward and we're going to share of the bread and the juice. And I'm going to ask you to do it just a little different today, if you don't mind. If you feel comfortable, I'd like you to come up in a group of two or three, or four if you need to be. I'd like you to come up and actually take a piece of the bread and give it to the person you come up with. If you don't feel comfortable doing that, that's fine. You can come up by yourself. We'll still give you a piece of bread. But if you feel the way to do that, then you just simply take the bread and give it to your friend and say, "This is the body of Christ broken for you." And then the communion stewards will be holding the cup for you to dip it into. But one of the reasons I was thinking about that this morning, I was thinking about sharing the bread in this way, is to remind us of the fact that we are all unified, one in Christ. We are the priesthood of all believers. It's not just me who hands out bread. Each of us are ministers in the body of Christ, serving one another. As we listen to the special music, I'd ask the communion stewards to come forward at this time so we can celebrate this meal of grace together. This time we'll be receiving our tithes and offerings. Just as a reminder, I'd encourage persons to fill out their stewardship of attendance or the little prayer note cards. We've been doing that a little bit differently recently, and it's a little tear-off sheet in your program. We especially really covet your prayers, whether they be answers of joy or calls for concern. But we appreciate you filling those out so that we can be in prayer with you. We take these prayers and put them with the prayer team and the prayer chain, and my wife and I also pray over them. So we just want you to know that we'd love to be in prayer with you. I also wanted to let you know today is Worldwide Communion Sunday. You'll find a special envelope in there. And this is for ministries of Christian unity. And so each of the churches in our community and around the world are taking a special offering this day to help us work together in doing outreach together and doing movements of Christian unity. And so that special offering is there as well. This time, let us receive our tithes and offerings and bring them to the Lord.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sin became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
A fellow pastor friend of mine wrote this benediction, a prayer for World Communion Sunday, and it's one that really speaks to me. It's a little esoteric, but yet it also reminds us that on World Communion Sunday we still pray for peace and we pray for unity, even though we may be at the brink of war as a nation. I send this forth in this prayer for you this day as our benediction. Christ, our daily bread, welded into your image, wrapped in your body and blood, we become hungry and alive, and we become human. So forgive us when we choose inebriation, when we cast a forlorn face toward oppression and lie low in isolation, forgetting how we are habitually well-fed, for we are still feeling our way lowly and slowly to hollow our diminishments, to mourn an attitude of exclusive entitlement, to fast from grabbing, to fast from hoarding, to fast spending our way to salvation. Lord, help us to cease bombing our way into restored relationships and to taste and see that what you've made is good. Holy One, seed and shape us into a yeasty global rising. Plow the earth of our souls to true homeland security, to housing, debt relief, an end to torture, that as the unseen crumbs fall from our altars, unknown and used by grace, that you may be the embrace that holds and releases us again, the mimic to the oppressed. The two prodigal boys I see, one brother with a pistol to his temple, pop, pop, as I ask, do you know who to shoot? No, nobody, he says. This is the bread of affliction. Are you that nobody your brother would kill, the brother you gave your life for? Lamb of God, move us from maneuverings, not to worship communion itself, but to the beatitude of all creation that has been made in such a way as to feed us. Restore to us then our Eucharistic, our thanksgiving role, to receive and return praise in the form of fragrant, abundant bread and wine, until hunger becomes only a faint memory for all those we know. Amen.
If you're new to our church, don't forget to grab some bread before you go out. And also, we have coffee and juice and all sorts of wonderful things over there. Please stay in fellowship as long as you can. And stand as we send you forth with this song. Encourage you to do this week.
Trust in you, walk by faith, I walk by faith, each step by faith, to live by faith, I put my trust in you. Every step I take is a step of faith, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Here's a prayer of faith. Yet my God is for me, who can be against me? And I walk by faith, each step by faith, to live by faith. I put my trust in you. Walk by faith, walk by faith. I put my trust in you. One more time. All my faith, I put my trust in you.
Amen. God bless you. Have a good week.
Every step I take is a step of faith. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every prayer I make is a prayer of faith. If my God is for me, who can be against me? And I walk by faith, each step by faith, to live by faith. I put my trust in you.
Walk by faith.
Walk by faith. I put my trust in you.
Two more times.
Walk by faith. I put my trust in you. And walk.